accepted the Lord. And so life changed for them. And then my father began to do what they were doing. They just kept on going to the different farms. And my father, being a young man, he wanted to preach or to witness for Christ. And they came to this little farm, kind of abandoned, and they found an old lady and a young girl, teenage girl. They evangelized, and the old lady accepted Jesus Christ, and she was so happy. And that young lady also accepted, but she was about maybe 14, 15 years of age. And the concern that her grandmother had was that she wanted to go with the Lord, because every Christian, when they newly accepted the Lord, is, I know it in my case, that's what it was. I didn't understand Christianity very well, but I understood that heaven was better than earth, and that the life over there was better than the life I was living in. I wanted to go with the Lord. And the old lady wanted to go with the Lord, and of course she was old. But she was very concerned that her child, granddaughter, what is going to happen to her? She never had a mother. Her mother died giving birth. So her grandmother raised her. And here goes Sebastian, and he offered himself, "Oh, Lady Dorothea, don't worry. If you want me to, I can marry your daughter." And so that's what happened. And they both got married. And about 12 years later, in 1930, when the Great Depression came to America, they decided to go back to Mexico. And this is why I was born in Mexico. And I mentioned this with some pride, but also more pride about my mother. They didn't have a church over there. They couldn't establish a church. They encountered a lot of persecution, and it was very difficult. My father experienced extreme poverty, and then sickness, that he was not able to do anything. And this is where my mother, when she passed to Mexico, she refused to renounce the American citizenship, because she was born in Texas. And they hated her for that, because they thought that she was too proud of that, that she should be a Mexican. But my mother stayed firm. When she wanted to come back to Mexico, her marriage was destroyed because of the sickness. She was poor, no money, no nothing. And she prayed and came with the idea that if she could borrow money on us and she could come to America, work, save money, and go back and bring us to America. That's what she did. I don't have a concept of how much time she spent in America working to have the money to pay for the money she borrowed from us to come. We were there working and doing everything. I was just a little kid. I was fortunate they sent me to school, and I was able to graduate from first grade. In part, I went to second grade. My mother came, and she had always talked about America, that in America, you will never have hungry. You will always have something to eat. And she used to talk to us about ham. And of course, we don't have a concept what ham was, but she talked about it. She came, pick us up, and brought us to America. What I had found in America was a land of abundance and a land of liberty and a land of opportunity. We continue to be in America all the time, poor, following the crops. I became a good cotton picker, the best in the family and the best in town. At the age of 12, the Lord came into my life. By this time, my mother had joined and got together with this man, and the men liked me a lot. But when the Lord saved me, that men hate me a lot. And my mother, probably for my own good, she put me out of the house at the age of 12, 13. But praise God for that. And what I found is that God has been so good to me. He saved me. He set me free from my mother and the man he got together with. And then at the age of 15, actually 14, an evangelist came to town and spent 2 weeks at church. And this man had a beautiful way of preaching that I never seen before. The preacher will announce the preaching text, but he will not read it. He wanted somebody in the congregation to get up and read it. It was all in Spanish, of course, since I only had gone to first grade, and in America I was not able to go to school. But when the Lord saved me, they gave me a Bible, and for a year and a half, I read it through and through. I didn't understand everything, but I kept on reading. Now I understand that what the Bible does to Christians. We don't understand it. Keep on reading it. It's just like a baby. He feeds. He don't understand food. Probably adults don't understand where food comes from. This pandemic has taught us to find out where the food comes from. But we don't care. We just eat it. And the food does its job in giving us health and energy. So that's what it did for me spiritually. So when the preacher said the sermon is going to be in John 10:10, then immediately I found it. And I look around and everybody was looking. You know how the Christians are in church. Sometimes they couldn't find it. And the preacher said, young man, did you get it? You have it? Yes. Well, get up and read it out loud. So I got up, read it out loud, and he liked it. Then all the scriptures that while he was preaching, he just throw one after the other, and I was there. Well, that was my ticket. That evangelist took me out of town. He invited you go with me. I was only 14. The last day of the revival, I became 15 years of age. The next day we left. And thank God, he took me out of a little town, took me out of all through the states of Illinois, Indiana, Michigan, Ohio, back to Illinois, to Nebraska, Colorado, New Mexico, Texas. By the time we came, it was a year, just about a year. I thank God because God gave me a call in America. I was so young. At the age of 16, when they put me as a pastor, I couldn't believe it. But I was their pastor and preached. The people love it. And according to Ernie, people still love me. So God has been good to me. In America, I found that God bless our family, restore our family. Five of us brothers were all saved. Four of them became preachers of the gospel. And the other was just keeping an eye on all of us. Christian, but keeping an eye on us. And I thank God that in America, I found the liberty and the freedom to do so many things. When I came to California to study the seminary, I didn't know what God has in plan for me. I just came, as the Bible says, I was doing that, seeking first the kingdom of God, and all this thing will be added unto you. Well, somebody over here thought that I needed a wife. This girl wanted to marry a preacher. Well, finally, no matter how much I rejected her, the time came when I told her in her own words, I fell for her.
Okay.
And that's it.
Dad,
so God is good.
You have to give equal time here, Dad, if you don't want.
Yes. This is a sermon that takes about 2 hours. And I'm going to...
Keep and on I'm gonna going, go ahead. Go right ahead.
I'm going to conclude by saying that in this country, God saved me. God gave me a wife, a beautiful, wonderful companion, the one that I needed in my ministry. God gave me 5 sons and a daughter. They're the treasure to me. The Bible says they're all a blessing. Every child is a blessing. Claim it as a blessing. Pray for them, and God will move and change their lives. God has given me everything that I need. I'm not a rich man, I say. But somebody told me the definition of a rich man, a wealthy man, he says, is the one that has need of nothing. And whatever he needs, he can get it. And that's where I am. I have not any need of anything. And whatever I need, God gives it to me. And I praise God. This country is the greatest country in the world. It's not a perfect country. There's no perfect country. I'm not perfect. Nobody's perfect. God calls us justified. He put us in good standing. Not that we are, but he just makes us stand good before him. So in this country, we pray. And we're going to pray today for this nation. We're going to pray for the president. We're going to pray for all the people in leadership in this country. We're going to pray for the church in this country. We're going to pray for our families in this country. We don't have time to spend so much prayer. We're just going to mention it and keep it in our mind that we should pray every day. I do pray every day for our country and our families, and pray that God will bless. Let's spend a moment in prayer. Pray with me. Father, I thank you for my family. You save all my family. You brought us from nothing to be someone that you could call and use. Thank you, dear God. And I pray for my sons and daughter, all my 17 grandchildren, and my 8 great-grandchildren, wherever they are, oh Lord, your hand be upon them. I pray for our country, Lord. Bless our president. Give him the strength that he needs to lead. We pray for all the leaders in this country, the governors, the Supreme Court, all those men and women, they're serving our country. We pray for our church in America. Father, this crisis that we're going through, thank you because you're using it for your glory. As an example, I'm here talking to people hundreds of miles away that a month or two ago we never dreamed, and though we're reaching people around the world. Bless the church, Lord, that we minister in faith and in power, and that we will see this country change for the better. Heal the divisions and bring understanding in the name of Jesus. Change men and women for the better and for your honor and for your glory. We pray this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for listening.
Amen. God bless you.
Amen.
Oh my God. Amen. Oh my God. Amen. That was so nice. Oh God. That was so nice. Soothing. Oh my God. Oh, thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Thank you for coming.
Amen. So nice. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
No, I heard Jesus doubt. Jesus doubt was standing. He must have opened the book. No, he didn't do that. No, no. No, 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 no. All right, I'm about to mute Deacon Stout right now. All right, he's muted. All right. We got to keep this for the church meeting next time.
We could have
now. What a blessing. I think what we want to do tonight is I don't, I kind of feel like talking more with my father about some of these stories.
You guys should take that.
One minute, let me.
Yeah, because I'm trying to pull out.
Let me do this. Let me just say, Dad, thank you very much for coming on with us tonight. We really are grateful. Those of you who've got a camera, maybe you want to clap your hands and just thank the Lord for him giving his time. Amen. Even my dad's clapping. Amen. All right. but we really appreciate you coming. We're going to have to do this again. There's so much more there. And maybe we'll even just keep the line open and do some questions and answers, because there's a lot of history there. He barely scratched the surface, really, of the church life. He founded a church in 1961, raising kids, all the difficulties in this country. Just so many different things that we could have covered. And obviously we don't have too much, all of them one night, that would be too much. I did want to, kind of correct in defense of my mom. She says the story a little differently, that it was my father that came looking for her. But I think he wants you to buy the book and buy the book and see what the real story is. Amen. But what a blessing they both have been to so many people. They're well loved in California and in Texas. And now I think they're really well loved right here in Amber as well. So we praise God for that. Amen. All right. I'm just going to lead us in prayer. And then if we have, if you want to stick around afterwards and have some more Q&A with my father, we could do that. All right. Let's pray tonight and just lift up the various needs and situations that we know that we have. Let me share with you a couple of things. We're all kind of misty-eyed. Thank you. Brad Perry, many of you know Brother Brad, and he was in the hospital for a rather long time. And when the outbreak started, they put him on a ventilator. And I was wondering about that, but it worked out well. They got him to go to a rehab facility, and they moved him into a rehab facility. But we just found out today that in the rehab facility, somebody had the virus, and now Brother Brad has tested positive for the virus as well. So I want you to pray for Brother Brad Perry tonight and his family, his sister in particular. But pray for them. They really need our prayers tonight as they go through a rather difficult time in there. All right. And anybody else that has, I know that we've had a couple of people, usually it's been people outside, just outside of our church family that has had the virus and things like that. But I want to pray specifically for that today. That's the bigger concern that is hitting the country in so many areas, economically as well, physically, the way we're grieving now and how we have to do things from a distance and so away. So let's pray about that tonight. If you can just join me in a moment of prayer for our country. Father, we come before you right now, and Lord, so many needs we have to present before you. We want to lift up every family that's represented here on this prayer line tonight, and praying, Lord, that you will bring healing to those who are sick, praying that you will protect those who have not been diagnosed with this disease, praying, Lord, that you will just bring restoration. I'm praying, Father, that you will do marvelous works in families tonight, that in this whole pandemic, that families will get closer together, that families will be more in love with each other and more positive toward each other, that there will be forgiveness and healing taking place in families tonight. I pray, Lord, for Brother Brad Perry, Lord, who came down, he's positive with this virus. And so we want to pray for healing for him and a miracle for him and all those in the rehabilitation center where he's located in Lansdale. We just lift them up to you, all of them, Lord, and pray for a miracle to take place and for healing to take place there.
Yes.
So many people, Lord, we've been praying for and lifting up to you. We lift, continue to do so and believe, God, that you are a healing God, that you are a miracle working God, that you can turn situations around. I thank you, Lord, for my father and his testimony and how, Lord, the family came so far. And in this country, how you've done so many great things in our family history here. We thank you for that, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that every family in this country will experience a liberty, a joy, a peace. And justice will roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. For not everybody in this country has had a wonderful experience. So many people are still suffering. So many people are still being pinpointed. So many people are targeted, Lord. But we lift them all up to you, Lord. In every situation, we've learned to say thank you. We've learned to trust you. We're not giving up on you, Lord. And we're not going to stop praying for this country. We pray, Lord, from the top to the bottom, all over the country, that there will be revival in the land, that the Holy Spirit will sweep over this, this country, and that there will be humility, that there will be repentance, that there will be a restoration and redemption and new creations in people's lives, that there will be a mass revival, Lord, that the Holy Spirit will warm over the entire country, that this may be a nation that's on fire for Jesus. Yes. Bless this nation, Lord. Heal us of our sins. Heal us of all of our wrongs.
Yes.
Lord, allow us to come back to you and to call upon your name sincerely, Lord, with integrity and not for show and not for any kind of outward look. But Lord, that we may be real with you, that we may have revival within our own hearts. Let it start with me, Lord. Let it start with us individuals. Let it start in our church. That revival will start at Zion. That revival will start in individual lives and families. And that revival may sweep over the nation and change this nation, heal this nation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. God bless you all. If you want to go ahead and sign off, you can do that. Dad, are you, how do you feel? You feel like you have to some answers? Are you fresh? Are you tired? You want to go to sleep? What's happening?
No, I'm retiring.
I'm retired.
That's all I do now. Go ahead.
If you have a question for my father, if you have the ability to, if you're on the cameras, you can type your question in.
It's only 4:30 in the afternoon for him.
What's that? Yeah, it's still early. It's still only 4:30.
Yes, you trying to put the man to sleep.
Well, you know,
I have another.
Before he gets up and goes to sleep.
Talking.
All right. I'm going to go ahead and get you for a second, and then I'll get Dad. Dad.
Yes.
Let me just ask this. Talk a little bit about what it was like to start a church when you and Mom and the family did that. I wasn't even around yet, so the best part hadn't even happened yet.
Wait a minute.
Anyway, can you talk about what it was like to start the church and how that came about?
Well, we are very humans, and over in Texas, I was pastoring when I was at the age of 25, and had many problems, a lot of misunderstanding, and I felt that I was very much misunderstood and accused of many things that were not criminals, anything like that, but just problems in church. And I felt that that my world had come to an end over there, and I felt lost. I felt that I had to come back to California with my wife and children. And when I was over here, I didn't want to be a pastor anymore. But I remember that all the churches closed the door on me, and I didn't go to church for about 2 months. And my mother-in-law, which was a very Christian woman, a woman of prayer, she was so concerned about me. And the last day she went to that church where she was going, she said, "We're going to resign." And when all the family, when she came back, he says, "Aureliano, we all resigned the church. We don't have any church. You're the man of God. You know what to do." And of course, I didn't want nothing to do with church. And so she went in, and 5 minutes later, my father-in-law came in, and he said, "Did they tell you what we did?" And he said, "What?" "That we resigned." "Oh, yes. And what are you going to do?" And out of nowhere, God knows, out of nowhere, I said, "Let's eat lunch. And after we eat lunch, let's go out to the city of Almani and find an open place that we can rent for a church." And I surprised myself, but by 7 o'clock that night, we had a place to start a church. And it was the week of Thanksgiving. We had the service on Tuesday, the first service. And it was an incredible thing how the Holy Spirit came upon me as I was praying, because I was full of anger and full of all kinds of bad feelings. When I read the scripture, I felt the Holy Spirit of God come through my head all the way down, washing all the bad feelings and that loneliness and that anger and that despair went away. And the Church of the Redeemer started that very night. And 2 days later, it was Thanksgiving Day, and we got together for Thanksgiving service, and the rest is history.
Okay, a question came in on the chat. Talk about your education. How did you finally get educated?
Well, when my mother brought us to Texas, the only thing she knew how to do was field work. And so I was working in the crops, following the crops. And they put me to school first grade and working. But when they caught Mom with a child working, I was already about 9, 10 years. She put me to school in first grade. And next week, she moved to another area, 20, 30 miles away, find work, and kept on working. They caught up with her again, and the authorities, they put me in school first grade. And a week or two, and out we go. So I never graduated from first grade. So here it is. But when the Lord saved me, all the Spanish that I had learned in Mexico went into effect day and night. reading the Bible. I came to seminary. They accepted me because I was already a pastor. They need to educate me. I spent 3 years, and thank God for it.
Yeah, let me jump in there if you don't mind just for a second. The seminary that he went to, there was a group of Pentecostal Mexican churches.
Yes.
That started their own school because, like in a lot of cases, in the minorities anyway, they weren't allowing the minorities to go and matriculate at the other schools, at the seminaries and so forth. And same thing in the black community is true as well. They would start your own schools. And mm-hmm. same thing happened in the Mexican, let's start our own. And they started it in Spanish in California. And my father was one of the first classes to go. He was the first class, is that right?
That's cool. Yeah.
In California.
I graduated on top of the class. I don't know how I did it. But I had good grades, better than those that had graduated from high school and had some college courses. And here I was. They thought that I was a great thing.
So that was your Bible school training. And yeah. then you started the church in 61 and sticking with the education. Talk about how you continued your education then.
Yes, I went to Texas and spent about 5 years. Then we started the Redeemer Church in 1961. And I began to go to school, graduated from high school when I was about 35. And then later on, in 1978, this brother came over to me, a respected minister who thought that I was a great thing. He said, I want you to consider going to Fuller Seminary. And of course, I knew that I wasn't qualified for that. And he said, no, they're going to open the doors for all the Hispanic pastors. And I think you can make it. And when they check all my credits, they found out that I don't have enough credits to be accepted at Fuller Seminary, which is a very recognized school.
It's the best one on the West Coast.
They accepted me on probation for one semester. If I did the work, I will be in. If not, too bad. But in less than the semester, I was approved. They saw the work that I was doing, and you're in. And I spent almost 5 years, and I got a degree, master in theology. And for the first time after I received that graduation and that diploma, I felt like liberated. Because in the church, people were coming. They were graduating from high school. So I graduated from high school. People were graduating from college and university. And I was their preacher and pastor. And I preached, no problem. But I still feel that feeling. But when I went to Fuller Seminary and graduated, a sense of liberation, a sense of accomplishment came to me that I never had before. I had done it. God has done it. God be praised. And thank God. Then a few years later, well, in 1997, the year that my granddaughter that is there with Ernie, Armida,
yeah.
was born. In fact, I was at Harvard. First week at Harvard, and she was born in New Jersey. So I came over the weekend to see my granddaughter. So they gave me
it was a fellowship, wasn't it? They had a program for pastors who had served a certain number of years,
yes.
called a Merrill Fellowship.
Yeah.
And if you were admitted into this program, you got to go for a year and take whatever courses you want free of charge.
Yeah.
And they gave you housing and food for a year, but you just had to take the year off and go to school. And Dad was accepted as a Merrill Fellow.
And Dr. Jesse Miranda, a great leader of the of the Pentecostal churches approached me and said, I have been commissioned to find the best pastor to be the first Hispanic to go to Harvard. And he found me. And I told him, no, I can't do that. I'm not qualified for that. Oh, no, you are, and you're going to. So I went, and I finished my education at Harvard University. Cambridge, Boston, Massachusetts. And my son only went to Princeton.
Only.
Oh, Dad. Okay, next question. Oh, too much. Let me see if there's any other questions. I don't see anything else on the chat. So let me see if I can unmute the line. Does anybody have a question you'd like to ask my father?
We'd just like to thank him for sharing with us this evening.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Amen.
Yes. All right. Yes, thanks.
Amen.
Pastor, bring him back again.
Bring him back again.
Right. Yeah, he's so yes. He's
amen.
So
amen. Amen. So amen.
Yeah. This is this is the best way. It doesn't cost me nothing.
I know that's right. All right.
In a few minutes, I have dinner, and then I go to, then I attend another prayer meeting like this at church.
What got me about my dad was when he went to Harvard, and you know, I had gone to Princeton, and I graduated in '91, and I got married in '94, and he went in '97 to Harvard. And when I graduated Princeton in 91, I drove from New Jersey to Texas to see the family and tell them that I graduated and show them my diploma and everything. But when Dad went to Harvard, man, all the family was saying, finally somebody went to an Ivy League school. You know, and I can't win, man. I cannot win with this guy. Dad, what's yep. the phrase, Dad? You're too much.
And you?
When
Ernie was about 5 years old, he was a very a very cute little boy with a mind of a 15 or 20 year old. And I used to tell him, Ernie, you're too much, Ernie. Where'd you get that from? You're too much. And he said, and you're not enough. So that's Ernie.
Yep, that's Dad. Anyway, let's pray. We'll just be dismissed this evening. Thank you all for coming and sharing with us. And I know that he's such a blessing to me. I trust he's been a blessing to you as well. And I do hope that we have him back again another time. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this evening, and thank you for this blessing that we've had of Zion Baptist Church of Ambler. The family here, Lord. The atmosphere of our congregation is family, and I'm glad that my father is now able to see that and experience that with me. Bless this group, Lord. Everyone who was here tonight and those that couldn't be here, we pray for them as well, that Zion Church will continue to grow, continue to spread the good news, continue to make disciples of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We were truly blessed.
I don't even know how to turn it off, because I keep hitting turn it off, and
I'm blessed.
I see my contact lick and everything else, but he's still talking.
Yes. I'm blessed to be able to be heard.
I don't know how to cut him off,
amen.
Man.
Thank you.
Oh, look at my dog is on the front page. I see Precious, but I can't turn him off.
Treat that man over there, my son. Treat him kindly. He's my son.
I'll try.
Maybe two. Treat him very kindly. And the girls more.
Yes.
No, I didn't get feedback. I just couldn't hear him. While he was talking, I couldn't hear him until Pastor unmuted him.
Yes.
And when he did that, then I could hear him talk. But I guess when Pastor muted him, I couldn't hear him while he was talking. So I was muted too. But I can't turn him off. How can I turn him off? I can't turn him off.
Who's that? I can't do that.
Look at Tasha.
Tasha.
Is that Debbie? Debbie who?
Hi.
Did she get off yet?
Yeah. Hey, Tasha Lee's over here.
Hi, Tasha.
Hi there.
And over here is Vicky
Stickers. Armina.
God bless you.
We know you're going to come make breakfast.
Yeah.
Hungry. Nobody makes breakfast like our meat, okay?
Oh.
I can't win, you know? I tried my best, Dad. Jeez. That was my thing. I would go over there every time I would visit. The day that I got there in the morning, I would make breakfast for Mom and Dad. Chorizo con huevo, good Mexican breakfast. But I taught my kids to do the same thing. So when Armida went to California to live there, she started going over there on Saturdays and making chorizo con huevo and papitas and everything. And hers are better than mine. So,
Ernie, you're a good cook, terrific cook.
Thank you.
And your daughter cook.
You know what? I don't put that much pepper on it. That's why.
Yeah.
Okay. God bless you.
Right, thank you, Grandpa.
Bless you. Right. I gotta go to the next meeting. Okay.
All right.
You go to bed.
We'll see you next time.
My day's still young over here.
Give her a hug for us, please.
Amen. Bye bye.
All right. Bye bye.
Thank you all for coming.
Bye bye. Good night.
Amen.
Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Good night.